Right, scalpel. Are you looking at me, guy?
We're losing adrenaline now.
You'll never amount to anything, Pat.
Everybody clear. You scum.
We've lost him.
The Games Master, the show that takes the competitiveness of 15 to 1, the drama of Brookside, and the humour of Whose Line Is It Anyway, puts them all on the line and says, bog off, we can do better ourselves. And over the next 25 and 3/4 minutes, we're going to prove it. Last Friday, Nintendo's Ultra Secret Ultra 64 console came out to play in Tokyo. The bad news was many of the games on show were still far from ready, but Mr. Good News was still pulling on his trousers, as these shots indicate. We'll have a full report on the staggering Ultra 64 later on in the show. Saturn owners rejoice! Many so-called exclusive PlayStation titles are being converted for your machine, including Destruction Derby and Wipeout, once voted number one reason to buy the Sony machine. Top PlayStation beat-em-up Toshinden was also released last week in Japan for the Saturn, with an extra fighter and intro animations. A comparison of the two versions reveals the Saturn surprisingly adept at matching the PlayStation's much-touted graphic capabilities.
3, 2, 1, action!
Keeping middle-aged Americans off the street is Robot Wars. The second year of the event in California recently saw 20 remote-controlled robots go head-to-head in a series of fight-to-the-death rounds to find the toughest robot alive. Designers used a plethora of approaches, from the flamboyant to the plain stupid, but in the end, the event was won by a vicious motorized bread bin.
A unanimous decision for Master!
A similar UK event is planned next year. If you're interested in taking part, watch out for the address at the end of the show. They say money is the root of all evil, although speaking as someone who has tons of the stuff, I'd have to disagree. If you have similar sufferings, then see if any of the following games are worth lightening your fiscal load for. First up on the PC, the game that was supposed to come out 47 years ago. Steven Spielberg and George Lucas co-present The Dig.
This one has a Steven Spielberg plot. Now, as graphic adventures go, they normally live or die on their plot. This seems to be slightly too serious for me.
The games that went before it, Day of the Tentacle and Full Throttle, were both very humorous and very polished. But this one just seems to have the polish without the heart, and I think as a result, it could fall flat on its face.
It's the puzzles that are going to really count, and fans of the genre aren't going to be disappointed when it comes down to that.
Next up, drive cars through bumpy roads with your arm round a lady while listening to loud rock anthems in Sega Rally on the Saturn.
The attention to detail is stunning. It runs at 40 frames per second, which is even faster than Ridge Racer. It has a two-player split-screen option, and there are things in there like customizing your car, time attacks. It's got so many options in there. Sega have really pulled their finger out on this one. This is going to be massive.
The actual gameplay itself is extraordinarily fast. The speed of the game is so astounding, it makes Ridge Racer look like your old granny driving a Reliant Robin.
On the time attack, there are hidden cars to discover, and there's a really good commentary running right through the game, warning you of tight corners coming up, whether they're left or right, so you can prepare yourself. Yep, Sega Rally is going to be a huge hit on the Saturn, and it's a very good reason to give Sega's console good consideration this Christmas.
Finally, more toys for the boys as gung-ho military types fire Freudian rockets in a psychoanalyst's dream. Warhawk on the PlayStation.
It's one of those games where you fly across great expanses of land, it's completely flat, nothing going on, and all of a sudden out of nowhere, up pops an enemy building for you to shoot at. How convenient.
Now, Dave's probably of one of those shoot-em-up mentalities that likes to shoot anything that moves. This is far more strategical than that. There's only 6 missions, although each one is split up into different sub-missions. Other than that, I don't think it's going to last too long, but it is a good game while it does.
Yeah. Father Time is prodding us towards our celebrity event. This week, it's a bit different, it's a first for us, and it's called Get That Celebrity on the Phone Now. Isolated punters, tired of sitting at home playing with themselves, are rapidly turning to the phone lines for comfort. Yes, many of the latest PC games come with modem capability, allowing modem owners to connect over the phone lines to other players and exchange in some top remote games playing shenanigans. Doom, Mech Warrior, and Screamer are all PC games that quite literally have this facility, as does the game that forms the basis of GamesMaster's first ever modem challenge, Virtual Pool.
It's time to chalk up our tips now, as the next challenge I've prepared is on the impressive PC title, Virtual Pool. Our two contestants will be playing the nine-ball game, in which each of the first eight balls must be potted in sequence before the final nine ball is sunk. Whichever player sinks the nine ball wins the game, and thus the golden joystick.
And here to take part in today's celebrity event, please welcome Melanie Yearsley. Welcome to the show, Mel.
Welcome.
Now, Mel, you've been involved in a lot of humorous stories in your life. Let's start off with one where you had the prank going wrong.
Oh, yeah. That was when I was at college and I was with some friends, and to promote this party I was trying to organise, we dressed up in sort of terrorist outfits like balaclavas.
As you do.
Drove around town, you know, with these fake guns. Went to college, stormed the college, mm-hmm. got all these flyers and stuck them on various people, had lots of loud music playing. And I tied up a few people and had some handcuffs as well.
Uh-huh.
And
I don't think we need to delve too deeply into that part of it.
You know, no? It was quite fun. And left, came back to college, and the head of department came in and told me that the whole of the police force in the area had put out roadblocks, and they got helicopters out as well.
Right.
Because I didn't realise there's an army base just down the road.
So what you're telling me is you're just a total delinquent.
Yeah, well, you know, that's what
and
I enjoy doing.
And you shouldn't be trusted. At all. You're quite lethal.
Yeah, that's about right.
And dangerous. Well, as top as that story is, and as fine a lady as Mel is, she's not actually technically a celebrity. We do have a celebrity here, but it's a little bit different because the first time ever we're going to be doing a challenge on the phone lines via modem. We do have Ronnie O'Sullivan on the other end of this telephone. If I pick her up, he should be there now. Hello, Ronnie.
Hello.
Hi, Ronnie. How you doing?
All right, not bad.
Listen, Ronnie, you made £285,000 in prize money, 1994-95, right?
Yeah.
That's a lot of money, isn't it?
It's all right, isn't it? It's not bad. It's not a lot after the tax man's finished with it, though.
Tell me some fantastic things you bought with that money.
Not really much, really, to be honest with you.
Didn't splash out in a flashy motor or that?
I did buy a car, but I had to sell that because I lost my licence not long ago. So
I don't think we need to delve into that. It's probably just a humorous prank that went wrong.
Yeah, that's right.
Any snazzy clothes on that you bought?
Nah, just a few bits and pieces, but nothing, you know, outrageous.
Uh-huh. Just to paint a little bit of a picture for you, Ronnie, you're playing against Mel tonight. You can't see her because she's down in the studio, but
right. She's
kind of like, looks like a funky wee clubber kind
Ooh,
of
she
girl.
She is.
She is, yeah. She's very cool, very trendy. Looks a bit like a Smurf, actually.
A Smurf?
A Smurf. I'm not sure if you've ever played against anyone who looks like a Smurf before.
No, I've never played against a Smurf before.
I mean, Stephen Hendry looks a wee bit funny, but not exactly Smurf-like.
Nah.
All right, well, listen, Ronnie, if you hang around there, we'll get ready to play the challenge after the break, and we'll talk to you then.
All right, mate.
All right, thanks,
Bye.
Ronnie. OK, as I said then, we're going to take a quick commercial break. Coming back in part two, if the telephone lines keep as they are, we will have Ronnie O'Sullivan against Dangerous Mel on the phone lines. Join us in a couple of minutes. We're ready for some top phone line game playing action here with Virtua Pro. We've got Mel here, who's incredibly dangerous and almost got arrested for being a terrorist once. Someone who hasn't been arrested for being a terrorist, but is a top snooker bloke. Ronnie O'Sullivan, who's on the end of the line here. You still there, Ronnie?
Yeah.
All right, mate, listen, have you made any more money during the break?
No, not sitting here.
Still on that, I want to stress that again, everyone. 285,000 quid this bloke made last year, and he doesn't even work for Channel 4. That's fantastic. Okay then, Ronnie, if you'd like to get ready to play, we'll be starting in a couple of seconds.
All right,
mate.
Cheers.
Thanks. And Mel, if you'd like to go and plump your backside down in the games playing area, I'll go up and have a chat with Rick. All right, Rick.
Hello, me old mucker.
This fine figure of masculinity beside me, for those who don't know, is Rick Henderson from PC Review. Rick, any tips for Mel and Ronnie?
Well, apart from hanging around in suspect pool halls and learning your trade from dodgy villains, I would suggest that Mel lets Ronnie clear the table. It's American nine ball we're playing, mm-hmm. which means you have to pot each ball in sequence and then the nine ball. But she could basically let him pot every other ball but the nine ball, leave the nine ball on the cushion, she pots it, she wins.
And thus not wasting any needless effort.
No, she's sitting down already, so yeah. It's...
Fantastic couch slot potatoes guide to playing pool from Rick Henderson there. Like you said, it is nine ball. The aim is to pot the nine strike ball at the end, but you have to pot them all in order. You can pot the nine ball, though, before potting the rest, but you have to use it as part of a pot of one of the other balls. That's completely clear for everybody at home there. Fantastic. Okay, so Mel is breaking first. Best of luck. Off you go. I was going to hit this one straight on here. It's a bit of power.
Oh no.
One colour ball and one white down, which means that Ronnie has got a foul shot. He can place this anywhere, Rick, can't he?
He can place it anywhere on the table that he likes. The one ball is on the left over the centre cushion.
Okay, so he's going to be looking for position for the two ball as well. Of course, you don't get two shots because this is the American version, not the rock hard, trendy British version.
He must be chalking the tip off that cue.
There he goes, nice long stretch there. Yes, and that's the one ball saver then for Ronnie.
And the two ball is the blue one up on the top left-hand side.
He hasn't, he's left himself in a bad position on that one. He could, I suppose he could maybe try and slice, double it down to the bottom right-hand corner.
I think he might be going for the cut.
Oh,
he's got it.
Fine slight cut there from Ronnie to pop the number two ball now. Which one's the number three? Is it that red one there or is it the orange one?
It's the red one, the red one.
Okay, the red one there. Behind the orange, that was a good shot. Nearly potted the orange as well there. He might leave that one sitting there for Mel. No, it's just run
gone
to safety
too far.
There. So now it's Mel's shot. Okay, Mel just getting an angle. She could actually cannon it in off the orange ball at the bottom there.
Again, taking a long time to actually cue out the shot.
It says stroke cue there.
Nobody seems to be using any side or anything at this moment.
No, they're not. And I have to say, a very poor shot from Mel. It was an attempted snooker. I don't think she's got that there.
He can't pot it. I'm pretty... Pretty
I
sure
would never
that.
Write off this young man. Write him off at your peril, Rick. Here comes Ronnie. Oh!
Cheeky.
Making Rick eat his words there. That was a fantastic pot there. Now we're on to the orange.
Perfectly lined up as well.
Fine
by
shot.
Some twist of fluke. In fact, that last shot is the sort of thing that gets you glassed down in Woolwich. Oh, but
I'm sure I can. That was a slight miss there off the two bottom edges of the pocket. Now it's Mel has a chance now to five ball, orange.
Oh, she's going to want to move the cue.
I reckon.
But she's going to go for it anyway.
She's going to go for it anyway.
Oh, cunning.
Clever.
But actually didn't do anything.
No.
Actually, no point to that shot whatsoever, but it was quite spectacular.
Lulling Ronnie into a false sense of security, perhaps. Here comes Ronnie, still on the orange five ball. Good old
goes for the
there.
Double.
Goes for the double.
Is it in?
It's not in, though. He's missed that one. But left it quite safe.
And here we go.
Just lining up the shot here.
Oh dear.
That was like when that fat kid comes behind you and gives you a little bit of a push.
A little bit of a
in
nudge.
In the pool hall there, of course. So it's a foul then, so Ronnie can move the ball to anywhere on the table. So he's obviously going to line this up. So he's got perfect positioning off the five ball to move on to the six. And here comes Ronnie, giving it a good back again. Fantastic court there.
Overrun
it. Superb. Oh, no, he has. You're right, Rick. Overrun it. Although, he's come the right-hand side of it.
Oh.
Playing a little bit wrong there. It might roll on to leave Mel set up for it.
This would be a good shot from Mel. She can pull it off. She seems to be aiming for the pocket, which I would advise.
Maybe she knows something we don't know, Rick. Well, I do. Dress up as a terrorist and nearly get arrested. Okay, that was a spectacularly awful attempt by Mel. In fact, that might roll to... Left
almost.
It on the lip of the pocket for Ronnie. But remember, of course, it's the person who pots the strike nine ball who wins. So all of this is mere snigger foreplay.
A bit of foreplay. A bit of a spectacle. It's like John Virgo's trick shot.
It is, only funny. Okay, that was another fine pot there by Ronnie.
If he manages to get the double here, he'll be perfectly set up for the eight ball.
Again, giving it another good whack there. Fantastic, he trebled that one. That's the seven ball, and now he goes for the eight ball. Two balls left, but of course, you know, if he gets this in and fluffs on the nine, and Mel can just step in there and win. Oh, fantastic long pot there, Rick, wasn't it?
He's now coming true to form.
Ice cool, this is it. Mel still hasn't got a single ball. This is surely going to be an easy shot here for
Ronnie.
This
has got to be easy, but if he leaves it over that pocket, you never know.
There he goes, he lines up. Oh, he's overcooked it a bit. Hammered it, a little bit of flash, a little bit of showman coming in there, Rick.
He's left it pretty safe because there is a good chance that the white might go in off this into the top right-hand corner.
That's true. Let's see how Mel Dush is just taking aim here. That's looking a little bit better, Rick.
Yeah, that's a good position there. This could be the
actually,
winner.
I should actually miss it from here, I just suddenly thought. No, I see again. It was too slim.
Too slim.
And now this leaves Ronnie with quite a difficult long pot. Making the final adjustments. Putting it back. And he whacks it again.
And again, it just overcut it.
Oh, he's a dashing gay blade of a pool player, isn't he?
And now he's left it in a very dangerous position indeed.
Now, this could be curtains for Ronnie here. This is a very easy pot here for Mel. But she's coming the wrong
side. Going the wrong side of the ball.
I think she wants to go more. That's a little bit better there. Almost as if she's listening to us.
Almost as if she is in the same place as we are.
She's pulling back. Oh! That's the last time Mel takes advice off us, Rick. Glass against the pocket. And now it's Ronnie. And of course, this will go down in history as the battle of the nine ball.
It certainly was. It's like Dennis Taylor versus Steve Davis.
Except
the championship's 1985.
Oh, and it's in. That was it. He was given one chance too many by Mel. Ronnie sinks his right line by four. Ronnie O'Sullivan is the winner. Mel. We've had a couple of shows, you know, a good couple of shows under our belt in this series now. I think I can safely say, not only was that the most appalling performance we've had so far, it probably will be. We'll stand as that for a long, long time.
Well, I just thought it'd be a bit different, you know.
Difference is one
bad.
Word. Is one word for it. Yes, it was very bad. At times you were actually going under the table. How was that helping your aim?
Not a lot, I don't think. I think I got a bit confused with some of the buttons.
Yeah, I mean,
not a lot of them, but, you know.
It wasn't just poor pool. It was also a remarkable ignorance of basic laws of physics. You said you did go to college.
Yeah, but I was concentrating too much on terrorist activities.
Of course.
Against Ronnie.
Yeah, as you do. Okay, well, thanks very much for coming on, Mel. Not huge thanks, but kind of that size of thanks for coming on. Round of applause for Mel. And, of course, on the other end of the phone line, the victorious Ronnie O'Sullivan. Ronnie, you there?
Yeah.
Ronnie, first of all, you played a fantastic game.
I did, yes.
You only took all of seven chances to put on that strike nine.
It's a very tough game, and I think I've done very well just to make it on seven chances.
You did.
I think Mel helped me because she was very poor as well.
She was very poor. Not the toughest opponent you've ever faced.
No, not really. It's probably the easiest.
Well, listen, thanks very much indeed for joining us on the telephone, Ronnie. And
Thank you.
If you were here, we would present you with a golden joystick in person, but we're going to stick it on the quickest dispatch rider
I'll make it the quickest.
It will be. It'll be there as soon as possible.
Cheers.
Okay, thanks for joining us today, Ronnie.
Cheers.
All right, round of applause for our special guest, Ronnie O'Sullivan. Yeah! And the phone, who's played a major part in this. Fantastic piece of phone action there. Okay then, we'll restore things to a more sense of normality here as we go to today's feature. It is the most powerful games machine in the world. It has a new controller that offers a different gaming experience, and it promises next-generation versions of some of the most popular titles ever. It's Nintendo's Ultra 64, and it was unveiled last week at the Shoshinki Show in Tokyo, along with demos of 13 games in development, and here exclusively for the first time on TV, all 13 of them. Super Mario 64, the wee mustachioed guy, goes all 3D on us. Super Mario Kart R, the top Super NES game, now goes four-player mental. Don't know what the R stands for, though. Kirby Bowl is 64. He's still fat. He still looks like a balloon, but now he's all 3D texture map polygons. Wave Race 64 looking suspiciously like Wipeout. Pilot Wing 64. You may be noticing some kind of running theme in the titles here. Next up, Buggy Boogie, you've guessed it, 64. And amazingly, a game that doesn't have 64 in the title, Blast Dozer, top mechanical buggy action ahoy. Shadows of the Empire provides the obligatory Star Wars tie-in for those of us who still think Mark Hamill's a well-adjusted human being. and GoldenEye, the GameCube version of the latest James Bond oeuvre, looking suspiciously like Virtua Cop. Body Harvest, no idea what this one's all about, but it involves a lovely wee man running around there, lots of big things chasing after him. Creator features great views of dinosaurs' bottoms. And Star Fox 64, the updated version of the Super NES classic, which I never actually liked. Finally, the Super 64 version of possibly the greatest game ever, The Legend of Zelda, once again, 64. This Pamela Anderson of a console is due for release next spring with a target price of £200. Four controller ports come as standard on the machine, but perhaps the most interesting aspect of the hardware is the controller itself. An obvious innovation is the central 3D stick, which allows precision 360-degree movement. It also controls the speed of the character, both essential tools for negotiating the next generation of 3D games. And because it's all 3D, different views can be chosen by pressing any of the four yellow buttons. The controller is covered in fire buttons as well. Cheeky left ones, cheeky right ones, and downright saucy underneath ones. With gameplay as complex as this, it's no surprise the controller also features a memory card, which enables you to save game positions and customize controller settings. Little wonder then that much of the excitement surrounding the machine quite literally comes from the gaming possibilities offered by it. However, the excitement of seeing the machine for the first time was tempered by the fact there was only two demos that punters could actually play. Kirby Ball looked pretty ropey, but even though it was only 50% complete, Super Mario 64 showed all the hallmarks of being an instant classic. The opening screen gives some idea of what's in store, featuring a fully rendered Mario head that players can manipulate in real time. Ooh, hours of fun there, I'll bet. Games journalist Gus Swan was one of the lucky few to have a go.
Mario 64 is quite a departure from Mario games in terms of gameplay, just by the virtue of it being in 3D. But it's not so different that you won't recognise the style and movement and the type of actions you're expected to perform. The bit that caught everyone's imagination and really made people happy about the machine was the Bowser boss. Just the speed of the graphics and the ingenuity of the effect was really quite different to what we've seen before in a platform game. One of its most striking graphical effects is the ability to take objects, polygon objects, close to the player without them becoming pixelated and blocky, as many players will be familiar with on other platforms. The stage we saw at the game, it was said to be 50% complete, and that perhaps explained why the levels were more sparse. There wasn't any levels where you were panicked with the amount of enemies or terrible jumps that you had to overcome. The size of the game may be up to 150 stages, and from what we've played of them already, it looks as if it's going to be extremely playable with lots of hidden features as you progress. So I don't have any doubts it'll be a great game.
So, after a year of leaving the next generation field open to Sony and Sega, the biggest video games company in the world is poised for a truly formidable comeback. Admittedly, the games themselves, costing £60, are well behind schedule. But from what we've seen so far, it looks like when it finally arrives in April, the Ultra 64 will be quite smart as it happens. And that's it. The sun sets on another Games Master, and I leave you with this thought. Life is a bit like a telephone call. It's great until you try to chat up someone who's engaged. Goodbye.